Hello.
Hello, can we start now?
Yes. I think Shaji sir is there. Please ask sir whether he wants to give some introduction of the talk.
Hello, sir. Shaji, sir.
Yes.
Sir, can you please introduce speak?
Yeah. I'm very happy that Rauf is giving the lecture today on a very pertinent topic, hypo and hypernatremia in children. This is something which we overlook at times, and then we come across a diagnosis, a proper diagnosis, and give us a pointer to the disease when we think about it. So knowing about it, keeping that in mind, and how to follow go about with it is what Dr. Rauf is going to talk to you about today. He's the pediatric intensivist at Baby Memorial Hospital, Calicut, a young a budding intensivist with a keen interest in academics. Let me tell you, even at his young age, he has published a lot of papers and he has written a chapter in a book. So with that introduction, Dr. Rauf, you carry on with your talk.
Thank you, sir. Okay, so a very good afternoon to one and all. So in next 1 hour or so, we'll be discussing sodium disturbances in children, which includes hyponatremia and hypernatremia, and I will try to give a simplified approach. So as we all know, these sodium disorders, they're a bit confusing and a bit difficult to understand. But I assure you that if you read it 2 or 3 times, and if you try to understand the concepts and imprint in your mind, then it's not that difficult. Okay, so though the title is a simplified approach, because the topic is about sodium, I will try to explain in detail. So be patient and kindly bear with me and kindly pay attention. So in order to avoid boredom, in between I will be asking questions. We'll have an interactive session, and I think Nabil, can you operate the chat box?
Yeah, sure. I can read out the answers.
Okay, fine. So in okay. So here we go. So the outline, the initial few slides will be on the basic physiology of water compartmentalization and sodium regulation in the body. It is essential to understand sodium disturbances. Then we will be dealing about hyponatremia and followed by hypernatremia. So we'll be spending more time on hyponatremia because it is a more vast topic. Okay, so coming to the body water compartmentalization, in a newborn child, 80% of the total body weight is by water. So in an adult male, it will be around 60%, and in an adult female, because of the larger fat proportion, 50% of the body weight is by water. So this is our first year or second year, what we have learned in first year MBBS. So out of the total body water, so the 60 total body water occupies the 60% of the body weight. So among that, the 20% of the body weight is by extracellular and 40% by intracellular. So in our body, 40% is solids, 60% fluids. Among that, 2/3 is intracellular and 1/3 is extracellular. So this extracellular includes our interstitial fluid and our plasma, that is our blood volume. So again, the composition of extracellular fluid. So the predominant ion in the extracellular fluid is sodium, and the predominant ion in the intracellular fluid will be potassium. So again, this is a basic concept of osmolarity and osmolality, what we have learned in our plus two. So osmolarity means the osmotic activity of the solutes per liter of the all solution. And osmolality means osmotic activity per kg of the solvent. So osmolality is the solvent alone, and osmolarity is the total solution. So practically, volume of the water, the solvent volume will be much more than the solute volume. Solute is negligible. Hence, this osmolarity and osmolality terms are used interchangeably. And for body physiology, we use the term osmolality. So there is no need to confuse between RITI and LITI. Practically, there is no much difference. And for all practical purpose, we use the term Osmola LITI. So how you calculate the plasma osmolality? So it is given by the formula 2 into sodium plus glucose in milligram per deciliter by 18 plus 1 by 2.8. So the normal value is 285 to 295. So we know the normal value of sodium is around 140. So 2 into 140 is 280. So out of this 290, 280 is contributed by sodium. So the sodium concentration is the major determinant of our plasma osmolality. So now what is tonicity? So tonicity, it is effective osmolality. So all solutes with osmolality, they does not contribute to the tonicity. So tonicity determines the osmotic force that mediates shift of water between ECF and ICF. So this is a concept which we need to understand. For example, a simple 5% dextrose approximate osmolality will be around 300. It is actually isosmolar, but it is hypotonic because dextrose as such is an ineffective osmoles. You give dextrose to the blood that will immediately diffuse to the tissue and it won't help in exerting any osmotic force. So that is why though the osmolality is similar to plasma, you never give a fluid bolus with 5% dextrose. Okay, so that is osmolality, but tonicity is different. Okay, so isotonic means, so our approximately our normal saline will be isotonic, Ringer lactate approximately isotonic. So these are isotonic and 5% albumin will be again isotonic. So 5% dextrose is isosmolar, but it is hypotonic. Okay, so now imagine, so this is our extracellular fluid, or imagine this is our blood vessel and this is our cell. So there is an always body tries to maintain an osmotic equilibrium between the cell and blood vessel. So it is there separated by semipermeable membrane. So imagine the osmolality is 290 and 290. If we add some concentrated solute, we are adding a salt solution to the blood, that is to the ECF. So what will happen? So body will try to maintain the osmotic equilibrium for which water will move from the cells to blood vessels, so that it will decrease the osmolarity of the blood, the plasma to the, it will try to bring down it to normal or trying to bring down to a equilibrium. Okay, so the plasma sodium is 140, glucose is 90, the blood urea nitrogen is 14. So calculate the plasma osmolarity. So you can give the answer in the chat box. I will give you 1 to 2 minutes. Nabil?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, sir. Are we getting answers?
Yeah, 290 by several answers are the 290.
Okay, okay. So it's a one of the simple question you can get, but it can be a OSCE question. So 2 into 140 plus 90 by 18 will be 5, and 14 by 2.8 will be 5. So it will be 290. So this is the calculated plasma osmolality. So we are calculating it using a formula. Now, for the same blood was sent to lab to calculate the osmolality, and the laboratory report of plasma osmolality came as 300. Okay. So there is a difference here between this 290 and 300. So what do you call that? So this is called osmolal gap. Okay. So the normal value of osmolal gap is less than 10. So the question is, give some condition where the osmolal gap increases more than 10. It is a tool which is used commonly in toxicology. That's a clue. So give answers.
Racillate poison, one answer.
Okay.
Then hyperglycemia, another answer.
Okay.
I think there are no other answers.
Okay. So osmolal gap indicates there are some unmeasured solutes or some unmeasured osmotically active substances other than sodium, glucose, chloride, etc. So normal gap is less than 10. So increase occurs with certain toxins like ethanol, methanol, ethylene glycol. So it is used in methanol poisoning or ethylene glycol glycol poisoning. So the osmolal gap will be increased. That is one of the, that is why it is used in toxicology. Now one of you answered hyperglycemia. That is not correct, because hyperglycemia, anyway, whatever osmolality contributed by hyperglycemia will be accumulated in our formula itself. In our formula, it does include glucose. Okay, but if the answer would have been DKA, that's the correct answer, because in DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis, there will be large amount of ketones. These ketones will contribute to some osmolality, so there will be increased osmolal gap in diabetic ketoacidosis. Okay, so now we'll move on to sodium balance. So we learned that sodium is the dominant cation of extracellular fluid or the dominant cation of plasma. So it is the principal determinant of extracellular osmolality. So it is necessary for maintenance of intravascular volume. So I tell you, sodium is the determinant of osmolality. So the sodium is like synonymous with osmolality. So whenever we are talking of hyponatremia, whenever we're talking of hypernatremia, what we are worried, what we are concerned is the osmolality. So all the clinical manifestations of hyponatremia or hypernatremia, it is because of the change in osmolality. Okay, so the change in symptoms of hyponatremia, all their symptoms of hypoosmolality. So always just imprint this concept in your mind. Sodium, we are talking about osmolality, we are concerned with osmolality. So the intake of sodium in our normal body, so the diet determines the amount of sodium ingested. Breast milk and formula is approximately this much milliequivalents, and the sodium is readily absorbed from food, and the presence of glucose increases the sodium absorption. That is the concept behind our oral rehydration solution. Okay, now the excretion of sodium, it is by stool. So there are by three routes. Stool, there is some sodium loss in stool. It is actually 50 MEQ per liter. So stool is actually hypotonic. So in a patient with diarrhea, we are losing hypotonic fluid. So by convention, diarrhea should cause hypernatremia, because we are losing hypotonic fluids. But because there is because patients or because children consume a lot of water during diarrhea, they develop, because they consume hypotonic fluid, they develop hyponatremia because of loose stools. So there are some age group, like extremes of age group, especially in infants who cannot regulate their thirst intake. The other will be old age extreme, old age age group who cannot regulate their thirst. In such patients, with diarrhea, they don't drink enough water. So that patient will develop hypernatremic dehydration. So that is why classically we see hypernatremic dehydration in infancy. Now, the sweat is another route of sodium excretion. So it is usually not significant, but it gains significance in conditions like cystic fibrosis. Now, the main role is played by kidney, which regulates the sodium balance, and it is the principal site of sodium excretion. So we don't need to go too very deep into the physiology. Some basic concept we need to understand how sodium is regulated. So there are two ways of regulating. One is by the pituitary using vasopressin secretion, and another is by the kidney using the RAS mechanism. So whenever in our body, whenever the ECF volume, or whenever there is a plasma volume decrease, or when it is causing fall in blood pressure, there are two mechanisms activating. One, the vasopressin gets secreted from hypothalamus, so which will act at the collecting duct and retain water. Now, when the ECF volume contracts, again the ECF volume decreases, our renin-angiotensin mechanism will be activated. So using angiotensin II, there will be sodium reabsorption at the proximal tubule, and using aldosterone, there will be sodium and water retention at the collecting duct. So this is the two mechanism happening when the blood pressure is ECF is come related to the ECF volume or plasma volume and blood pressure. Now another component is osmolality. So whenever a patient is having dehydration and the patient develops increased osmolality like hypernatremia and increased osmolality, this is the first mechanism to activate will be hypothalamus. There will be thirst mechanism. So patient will drink water and reduce the, which will lead to reduction of osmolality. Simultaneously, increase in osmolality will also activate the posterior pituitary to secrete vasopressin, which will also help to retain water. So on increasing osmolality, these two mechanisms operate, and decreased ECF volume, again vasopressin and RAS mechanism. But we have to understand that just one more thing, if the ECF volume is increasing, if there is a hypervolemic state, then the mechanism which activate is this baroreceptor gets stimulated and natriuretic peptides are secreted, which will lead to natriuresis. Now we have to understand, so there are two mechanisms. One is on degrees of the ECF volume, and second is with the change in osmolarity. So we have to, the volume depletion will take precedence over osmolality. For example, if a patient is developing decreased blood volume and hypotension, the same patient has decreased osmolality, so both are decreased. So in that patient, because of the decreased volume, decreased blood volume, vasopressor will be secreted, and vasopressin will be secreted, and RAS mechanism will be activated. So though the osmolarity is also decreased in that patient, so body will go in favor of the decreased ECF volume. I'm not confusing you. So there are, basically understand there are RAS mechanism, and from pituitary there is vasopressin mechanism. And this is a decision is taken by changing the extracellular volume and changing the osmolarity, of which the change in volume take precedence. Okay, so the renal handling of sodium, so in the kidney, the handling will depend upon different mechanism which will be affected by the change in volume and blood pressure. So it include RAS mechanism, which will be activated whenever there is a decrease in blood volume or blood pressure, aldosterone, which will be activated by angiotensin II, or if there is a hyponatremia or hyperkalemia, aldosterone will be activated, and if there is increased intravascular volume, the natriuretic peptides get activated. So just one important concept I want to emphasize. So it is the patient's effective plasma volume which determines the urinary sodium. So urinary sodium more than 20, it means that provided the kidney is normal, it means that the patient's effective blood volume or effective plasma volume is adequate. So if the effective plasma volume is adequate, the kidney urinary sodium will be more than 20. So the urinary sodium value is not depend upon the plasma sodium value, rather it is dependent on the adequacy of the intravascular volume. So in hyponatremia or hypernatremia, the underlying pathophysiology will determine the urinary sodium. So if there is a hypovolemia, urinary sodium will be less than 20, and FeNO will be less than, fractional excretion will be less than 1%. If there is a euvolemia or hypervolemia, urinary sodium will be more than 30, and FeNO will be more than 1%. This is when our kidneys are working normally. So this is an important concept. So urinary sodium more than 20 means the plasma volume or the blood volume is adequate. It does not mean anything about the sodium. It just means that the effective plasma volume is adequate. But if the effective plasma volume is not adequate and still the urinary sodium is more than 20, it means that there is some problem with the kidney. Okay, now sodium regulation. So sodium is unique among all electrolytes because sodium regulation and the sodium levels are determined by the water balance and not the sodium balance, which determines the concentration. So the first point I told, sodium, it's always sodium, it is synonymous with osmolality. The second point, important point, is sodium is determined, the concentration is determined by the water balance and not the sodium balance. So I will just try to explain. For example, you understand that a fluid of concentration of N by 2 saline. So 1 liter will approximately contain 77 MeQ of sodium. So it is a hypotonic fluid. So to any patient, if you decide to give 1,000 liters of 1,000 liters of N by 2 saline, so that is a good amount of sodium equivalents. But you are giving 1,000 liters of hypotonic fluid. So in that patient also, sodium level will fall. So it is not the amount of sodium you are giving; it's the concentration of sodium, the concentration of the fluid which you have used that determines the sodium levels. So this is the next important point. Okay. So serum sodium is 135 to 145 normal value. Osmolality we all know 285 to 295. So what happens when the sodium concentration increases in the body? There will be increase in osmolality. We know thirst will happen. There will be increased secretion of ADH, and body will try to conserve water. So both these mechanism will increase the water content, and sodium will return to normal. So this is the normal sodium regulation. So now we have completed the basic physiology part. Now we'll go to hyponatremia. So hyponatremia, by definition, it is less than 135 actually. So it's a common electrolyte abnormality in critically ill children. Up to prevalence is around 20 to 45%. This is less than 135. So it's said that various hospital-based studies have shown that among hospitalized children, 25% can have hyponatremia. So even in pediatric ICU, that is in critically ill children, the prevalence increases further up to 40%. There are many studies in children with bronchiolitis, pneumonia, which has shown that the occurrence of hyponatremia can be as high as 70%. So before discussing further, I will give you some 5 to 6 different case scenarios of hyponatremia. Each will be different from each other. And the aim of the talk is, I won't discuss further now, I'll just give the scenarios. So by the time I finish hyponatremia, all of you should be able to recognize each scenario, what type of hyponatremia is it, and how will you investigate each one, and how will you treat each of them. We will see different scenarios. So first is a 5-year-old child with dilated cardiomyopathy who was admitted with congestive cardiac failure and vitals. Child had some tachycardia, heart rate was 110, blood pressure was 96/60. Child had hepatomegaly, there was edema. Neurologically, the child was normal, and sodium level at admission of that child was 125. So this is one scenario. Now we go to another scenario. It was a 6-month-old child who was admitted with severe bronchiolitis. He was on oxygen support, was given 100% maintenance fluid of N by 2, 5% dextrose. And on day 3, sodium level was checked and it was 126. Third scenario, a 10-year-old child. He was a follow-up case of stage 3 tubercular meningitis, which was diagnosed recently. And he continues to have a low GCS, and child has polyuria, and child has tachycardia, and BP above 5th centile, and sodium in that patient was 115. Now, fourth case scenario, a 2-year-old child who developed acute gastroenteritis with multiple episode of large volume stool. Baby was given oral liquids at home for first 2 days. On day 3, baby presented to ED with seizures, and child had tachycardia and BP at lower centile, cold peripheries, and sodium was 122. Fifth case scenario, 4-year-old child diagnosed with first episode nephrotic syndrome. Urine albumin was 4+, triglyceride was 300, and you got a call from lab that sodium is 128 as an alert. So the last scenario, an 8-year-old child who is a non-case of type 1 diabetes, he skipped insulin for 2 days, and child presented with a diabetic ketoacidosis the next day. The blood sugar was 500, and again you got a call from lab, beware, the sodium is 126. So all these 6 cases are of hyponatremia, but each one is different from each other. So by the end of next 20 minutes, you should be able to recognize, classify, and treat all these patients. So coming to the etiology of hyponatremia in hospitalized children, so the first, the common reason is the impaired free water excretion in critically ill children. Then the inappropriate release of vasopressin, redistribution of sodium and water in hospitalized children, and the one of the commonest causes is the use of hypotonic fluids. In older days, isolate P was used as a maintenance fluid in older children. So you know that isolate P sodium will be around n by 5, roughly 32. So it's a very much hypotonic fluid. So it used to contribute to a lot of hospital acquired hyponatremia. Then there are some drugs and the primary illness per se can contribute to hyponatremia. So in hospitalized children, studies have found that the arginine vasopressin level or the vasopressin level or the ADH levels are high. So it has been proven in many studies. Okay, so what are the conditions? One, in physiologically it can be high in hyperosmolar state. In related to pulmonary pneumonia, severe pneumonia, pneumothorax, severe asthma, bronchiolitis, all these patients can have elevated vasopressin, elevated ADH. So by that I mean syndrome of inappropriate ADH, SIADH. So there are some drugs like barbiturate, carbamazepine, which can contribute to this increased ADH. Then hypothyroidism, again CNS infection, severe meningitis, encephalitis, tumor, trauma, all these patients, they have elevated ADH in their body. So in these patients, if you use a normal maintenance, even normal maintenance, 100% maintenance fluid or a greater of any hypotonic fluid, for that matter, even isotonic fluid in a normal maintenance, that can contribute to hyponatremia because these patients have a increased ADH. So what will the ADH will do? Out of the fluid you give, ADH will retain the fluid and excrete the sodium. So it will cause dilutional hyponatremia. So now we'll just learn how we approach. So hyponatremia, the first thing you do is serum osmolality. So serum osmolality, it can be normal, low, high. So I told you sodium, we are concerned with the osmolality. So if it is a true hyponatremia, the osmolality should be low. So the true hyponatremia is the hypotonic hyponatremia. So only because the sodium, all the symptoms are because of osmolality, only the hypotonic hyponatremia will have symptoms of hyponatremia or hypoosmolality. Okay, so what are the other two? So the other two we'll see. So one is if the osmolality is normal, so that is what we call pseudo hyponatremia. Okay, so this is actually a laboratory artifact. When the plasma contains very high concentration of protein, example multiple myeloma, or lipid, that is triglyceride, example like nephrotic syndrome, or hypercholesterolemia. So all these patients, the laboratory, there can be a laboratory artifact that the in this patient the osmolality is normal, but the laboratory can give you a false report of hyponatremia. Okay, so in true hyponatremia the osmolality should be low. So this laboratory artifact, it does not happen in the direct ion selective electrode method. So you see the newer generation ABGs, they give you sodium, they give you electrolyte report. So that sodium in ABG is calculated by ion selective electrode method. So this laboratory artifact does not happen in that method. But by conventional laboratory method, this artifact can happen in case of hyperproteinemia and hyperlipidemia. This is pseudo hyponatremia. Now again, hyperosmolality with hyponatremia. So where the osmolality is high, but the sodium is low. So why does this happen? So for example, this happened in classically happen in diabetic ketoacidosis when you have a very high blood glucose level, or when you have given mannitol, etc. So see, this is the blood vessel. This is the cell. So if you give other hypertonic substance like mannitol, or if there is a very high amount of dextrose, so water will move from cell to the blood vessel, so which will dilute the sodium, and if you measure the sodium level, it will be low. So this is a true hyponatremia. There is a hyponatremia, but there is no hypoosmolality. In fact, the osmolality is high. So these patients will not have symptoms of hyponatremia, or these patients, because they have hyperosmolality, they don't have the other symptoms of hyponatremia. So if you just correct this hyperosmolarity, for example, there is a high glucose level which has dragged the water inside. If you just give insulin infusion and this glucose decreases, so and the osmolarity get corrected, the automatically the sodium will get corrected. Okay, so that is why you calculate corrected sodium in diabetic ketoacidosis. For every 100 elevation in sugar level, there will be a decrease in sodium by 1.6. That's why, for example, if the RBS is 500, so imagine, so there will be 4 into 1.6, that much change in the sodium. Okay, now coming to hypo, now we are coming to the true hyponatremia, which is the hypotonic hyponatremia. Okay, so for that, the next step, now we have confirmed it is the true hyponatremia by checking the osmolality. Now we are going to the true hyponatremia. Okay, so the first one is hypovolemic. So the true hyponatremia, it is divided to three: hypovolemic, normal or euvolemic, and hypervolemic. So hypovolemic means patient has lost volume. So patient has lost both water and sodium, but the patient has lost sodium much more than the water loss. Okay, so the patient have signs of hypovolemia, which may include tachycardia, hypotension, cold peripheries, decreased CVP, all those findings. So again, so the patient has lost volume. It can either through the kidney or through the gut. Okay, so again, in a hypovolemic patient, so next step we are checking the urine sodium. So remember, in hypovolemia, the urine sodium should be less than 10, right? If the kidneys are normal, I told the urine sodium is more than 20 only if the volume status is maintained. So in a hypovolemic patient, we expect urine sodium less than 10. It means that the volume has been lost. It's an extra renal loss, dehydration, diarrhea, vomiting, extra. For in a hypovolemic patient, you find that the urine sodium is more than 20, which is against the proper physiology. It means that there is something wrong with the kidney. So either you have given diuretics, ACE inhibitors, or there is a mineralocorticoid deficiency, or there is a cerebral salt wasting syndrome. We'll come to that. So I hope you understand. So first step, we confirm the tonicity to classify it as true hyponatremia. Second step, we check the volume status. And if it is hypovolemic, we check the urine sodium. If the urine sodium is less than 10, it is extra renal loss. If urine sodium is more than 20, which is against the physiology, it means that there is some problem with the kidney, which can be because of the diuretic administration or some other issues. So again, so hypovolemic, so one of the cause could be gastroenteritis, one of the common cause in children. So I told you, in diarrhea per se will cause hypernatremia, but in gastroenteritis, hyponatremia happen because the children or the adult, they drink a lot of hypotonic fluids. So the common tendency will be to drink a lot of water. So that will result in hyponatremia. Now emesis, again, if the patient takes hypotonic fluid, burns, there is massive loss of isotonic fluid. So if the volume is depleted and the patient receive hypotonic fluid, there can be hyponatremia. Again, so it happens in cystic fibrosis. So coming to the renal loss, it could be because of the diuretics like thiazides or loop diuretics or osmotic diuretics. The other could be congenital adrenal hyperplasia, cerebral salt wasting, that we will discuss in detail. In case of severe cerebral injury, there will be natriuretic peptides, which will result in the loss of sodium. Okay, now coming to the last part. So we discussed hypovolemic. Now we are coming to the last part, which is hypervolemic. Hypervolemic means these patients have increased amount of total body water. So the classical examples would be congestive cardiac failure, liver disease, nephrotic syndrome, etc. So in these patients, what's happening? There's a decreased in effective blood volume. We all know, for example, congestive cardiac failure or nephrotic syndrome, the effective plasma volume is less because of the third spacing. So what happens? So because there is a volume depletion, I told you, body will try to retain water and sodium by ADH and aldosterone and other intrarenal mechanism. So these patients, though they're hyponatremic, their body, total body sodium is high, but their total body water is much, much more higher than the total body sodium. So they have hyponatremia. Again, it's a kind of dilutional hyponatremia. So in these patients, what will be the urine sodium? It will be less because the effective plasma volume is less. So the urine sodium, because you know congestive cardiac failure or the nephrotic syndrome, the effective plasma volume is less. The total body water is high, so the water is inside the. It's not the not inside the plasma. It is in the third space. Okay. So now coming to euvolemic hyponatremia. So euvolemia means that there is no evidence of volume overload, nor there is evidence of volume depletion. So there is an excess of total body water and slight decrease in total body sodium. So the classical example is, or the prototype is, syndrome of inappropriate ADH, SIADH. So where there is an inappropriate ADH secretion. So already the patient has good amount of volume, good amount of plasma volume. So, but still the body is producing ADH. So secretion of ADH is not inhibited by low serum osmolality or expanded intravascular volume. So there is good plasma volume, but still the body is and there is hyponatremia, but still body is inappropriately producing ADH, which will lead to further retention of water, and it will goes on, which will lead to dilutional hyponatremia, that is SIADH. Okay, so SIADH diagnostic criteria. So these 3-4 terminologies: SIADH, diabetes insipidus, cerebral salt wasting. So these all are important at the MD level. Can be asked in OSCEs or in theory examination. So what is the diagnostic criteria for SIADH? So to confirm SIADH, there should not be a renal or adrenal or a thyroid insufficiency, heart failure, nephrotic syndrome, cirrhosis. So all these all are hypervolemic conditions. So SIADH is basically euvolemia. And there should not be diuretic ingestion nor dehydration. So the patient is in a euvolemic patient where renal failure is ruled out. If you have urine osmolality more than 100, hyponatremia. So the first criteria is there is hyponatremia. The serum osmolality is low. So it means that it is a true hyponatremia. So in a and urine sodium is more than 30. It means that the volume status is good and kidney is working normally. But the urine osmolality is more than 100. So in a patient with hyponatremia, so there is excess body water, you expect the patient to excrete dilute urine. So if the serum osmolality is low, urine osmolality also should be low physiologically. But this is against the physiology. Even with a low blood osmolality, body is increasing the ADH, which retains the water, which concentrates the urine, and body is excreting concentrated urine, retaining further water, which will aggravate the hyponatremia. So that is SIADH for you. And again, if we restrict water, the hyponatremia might get corrected. So this is the criteria for SIADH. So SIADH, mind you, it's not a rare entity, it's a pretty common entity in hospitalized patients, in sick patients with whether it's a respiratory illness, severe pneumonia, severe asthma, whether it is a severe CNS infection, meningitis, encephalitis, malignancy, all these patients, there is a SIADH, body, the AVP levels are high, and there is a tendency to increase the ADH secretion and retain water. And there are some drugs like chlorpropamide, carbamazepine, all these drugs, vincristine, which can also cause SIADH. But so all these illness per se can cause SIADH. Okay, so now coming to symptoms of hyponatremia. Again, I tell you, hyponatremia, the symptoms are of hypoosmolality. So what will happen? So remember, this is a blood vessel, this is a cell. So when there is a hyponatremia, the osmolality has decreased. So remember that diagram which I showed in the first few slides. So the osmolality is less here. Now what will happen? Water will move from this less osmolar to higher osmolar. Water will move from blood vessel to cell, and it will lead to the swelling of the cells. So the cellular swelling can happen in any cells, but usually in the all cells except central nervous system, it's not a problem. But when this happens in the brain, the swelling of the brain cells, it leads to increase in intracranial pressure. So the symptoms can manifest as anorexia, nausea, emesis, lethargy, confusion, agitation, etc., and even seizures, coma. Okay, there can be hypothermia and altered breathing pattern. And even if there is acute, rapid, severe hyponatremia, very rarely it can cause herniation also because of the sudden increase in the ICP. Okay, so this is a diagram which you should remember again. So this is our normal brain. So when any insult, any change in osmolality happens, for example, suddenly this patient developed a hyponatremia. Okay, so the water will move from the blood vessel to the brain cells, and there will be transient cerebral edema. Now the body try to adapt over next 48 hours. What does the body do? So now body try to the body means the brain cells try to consume a hypotonic state by losing this sodium and some osmotically active substance, what we call idiogenic osmoles. So some osmoles brain cells gradually excrete and brain gradually adapt to the hyponatremia. So now by 48 hours or so, the brain has consumed attained a low osmolar state and has adapted to the hyponatremia, and brain has now relieved of the cerebral edema. So now what happens in such a state after 48 hours, if you rapidly correct the hyponatremia, so what will happen? So in such a patient, you are rapidly giving sodium injection to the blood vessel. So suddenly the tonicity in the blood vessel will increase, and suddenly, because now the brain is in a hypotonic state, suddenly the volume will shift from brain to the blood vessel. So sudden shrinkage of brain cells can happen, and if you correct a chronic hyponatremia, that is a hyponatremia which has passed more than 48 hours, if you correct it rapidly, there can be sudden shrinkage of the brain cells. That is what we call osmotic demyelination or central pontine myelinosis. So once it's a chronic hyponatremia, it should be very gradually corrected. So now again, the symptoms of hyponatremia, so all those symptoms we discussed in last slide, it is related to both serum sodium level and the rapidity of the decrease. For example, a chronically ill CNS patient with a chronic hyponatremia, he may be asymptomatic with a sodium of 110 or 115. But at the same time, a patient who had sodium of 140 today morning, somehow he developed a severe hyponatremia by today afternoon, he developed 125, he might throw seizures. So the symptoms of hyponatremia is related to the rapidity of the sodium fall and the level also. So usually these symptoms happen with a sodium level less than 125, these neurological symptoms happen, and usually seizures happen less than 120. But having said this, again, if a rapid fall has happened from 140 to 125 in hours, that can cause seizures. So just revising again, what are the steps in hyponatremia diagnosis? First, you determine the plasma osmolality for confirming whether that it is true hyponatremia. So true hyponatremia is there should be low osmolality. The second step is we check the volume status, whether it is hypovolemic, hypervolemic, or euvolemic to classify. So the third step is you check the urine sodium, which will help you to differentiate between renal and non-renal causes. So these three steps are needed in evaluating a hyponatremia. So just go through this again. This is now we are talking only about the true hyponatremia, which is hypotonic hyponatremia. So this is hypovolemic hyponatremia. So we checked the volume status here. Next, we check the urine sodium. So in the hypovolemic patient, if the urine sodium is more than 20, it means that your kidney is not proper. It is a renal loss. In a hypovolemic, if the urine sodium is less than 20, it is a extra renal loss. Okay. So euvolemic, the classical prototype is SIADH. You check the urine sodium. You see, it will be more than 20 because patient has euvolemia. So in that patient to classify, you can check urine osmolality more than 100. So in a hypotonic patient, in a patient with low osmolality, if the still urine osmolality is it's high, it means that there is some problem with your SIADH. There is some problem with your ADH secretion. It's not appropriate. It's inappropriate. That is what we call SIADH. Now, this is again, if again a euvolemic patient, urine sodium more than 20, then we checked urine osmolality is less than 100. So this can happen in primary polydipsia or what we call compulsive polydipsia. So usually it does not, this is not very common in children, but I have seen one kid, this can happen in neurologically abnormal children or children with some behavioral disorders. They drink lot of water. So if they drink lot of water, that is what we call primary polydipsia in a neurologically abnormal child. So that can produce euvolemic hyponatremia with low urine osmolality. Okay. Now hypervolemia, we know hypervolemia, usually the urine, because there is ineffective intravascular volume is low. So urine sodium will be less than 20. These are the common causes. If urine osmolality in sodium is again high in a hypervolemic with compromised intravascular volume, again means your kidney is at failure. So coming to treatment, so the treatment decision will depend upon the severity and symptoms of hyponatremia, the onset, the underlying disease, and the rate of correction and overcorrection. The most important is the judicious monitoring and avoid quick normalization. Okay, so now if the patient is symptomatic, so if a hyponatremic patient is symptomatic, like he has encephalopathy or seizures, the first treatment is you give hypertonic saline irrespective of the etiology, whatever may be the etiology, whatever may be the type of hyponatremia, you give a bolus of hypertonic saline to produce a small rapid increase in serum sodium. So the usual bolus is 5 ml per kg of 3% NS over half to 1 hour. So approximately 1 ml per kg of 3% saline will increase sodium by 1. So 5 ml per kg will increase the sodium by 5. So usually we say that this 5 ml per kg bolus is good enough to even in an impending herniation case, if you give 5 ml per kg 3% saline, that can reverse. Okay. So whatever may be, if the patient is symptomatic, you give 5 ml per kg 3% NS bolus, no doubt about that. Okay. So coming to symptom, if it is an acute symptomatic hyponatremia, it means that you know that you have checked the sodium yesterday and you know that the sodium was 140 yesterday, but today you see that within 24 hours, you see that the sodium has fallen. The hyponatremia, you know that, you know for sure that it has happened in last 48 hours. It is acute hyponatremia. So give 3% NS bolus if it is symptomatic, no doubt. And start correction, 24 hour maximum correction, up to 12 to 15 MeV is permitted in 24 hours. If it is a chronic symptomatic hyponatremia or you don't know the duration, for example, a patient, a meningitis patient, 3 days fever, headache, vomiting. Now the patient has come, sodium level is 128. So you have to assume it as chronic hyponatremia. So if the patient is symptomatic, you give 3% NS bolus and the maximum correction allowed will be 10 to 12 MeV in 24 hours. So that means 0.5 MeV every hour. So that is the maximum correction allowed. Okay, so now how we do the correction? Okay, so for example, take this example, 2-year-old boy, 10 kg weight, sodium was 115. He was lethargic. So the first treatment is whatever, irrespective of the etiology, is lethargic, is symptomatic, sodium is 115. Give 1 3% NS bolus, 5 ml per kg. And maybe in a ABG you check it after some time and the sodium is 120. Okay, so now how to proceed from here? Okay, so the sodium, we can calculate sodium deficit, which will be total body weight into target sodium minus plasma sodium. So target will be 135. So total body weight is, the formula is 0.6 into body weight. So 0.6 into body weight into 135 minus 120. So the sodium deficit is 90 MeV. Okay. So we need to give 90 MeV. So the difference, so from 120, we have to move to 135. So we assume that it is a chronic hyponatremia. We need a change of 15 MeV sodium. So maximum change is 0.5 MeV per hour. So we need at least 30 hours to correct it, right? So how can we do it? So you can give 3% NS 180 ml. So 1 ml 3% NS contain 0.5 MeV sodium. So there are different ways of doing it. We'll be discussing one by one. So for to give 90 MeV sodium, you can give 180 ml 3% NS over 30 hours, serially monitoring the sodium every fourth hourly. Or you can start a full maintenance NS or DNS and serially monitor and titrate based upon that. So all these are crude method. So if you ask a better method, so better method was given by Adrock Madias and it's famously called Adros Andromeda's formula by which you can calculate the anticipated change in serum sodium upon giving any fluid, any 1 liter of fluid. For example, to a patient with 120 sodium, if you give 1 liter of NS, what is the anticipated change in sodium? So we can calculate using this Andromeda's formula. So we'll go by a example. For example, the same child again. So 120. So usually IV correction we give till a level of 130 or so. If the level is sodium level is 130 and the patient is otherwise well active oral intake, you can just manage by oral fluids. The IV correction is, if the patient is symptomatic, we'll have to continue. Otherwise, till 130, the IV correction is enough till 130. Okay. So for example, the repeat sodium is 120. Now we want to elevate the sodium to 130. Okay, so now the patient is not symptomatic. Also, 120 to 130, the change is 10. So we need to do it in 20 hours, right? Okay, so using this formula, we can calculate. Imagine you decide to give NS to this patient. Giving NS to this patient. So if you give 1 liter of normal saline to a patient with sodium of 120, what will happen? So infusate sodium is 154 minus the sodium now is 120 divided by total body water will be 0.6 into 8. So 10, so 0.6 into 8 will be 6 plus 1, 7. So the change in sodium, so just concentrate here. So for this patient, 1 liter of NS, if you give, there will be change in sodium by 5. So you want a change in sodium by 10. So for this patient, you need to give 2 liters of NS. So you can give it in 20 hours. So you may charge the fluid as 2 liter of NS over next 20 hours. Now, but you imagine a patient with a 10 kg weight, giving 2 liters in 20 hours, it can lead to hypervolemia or it can lead to fluid overload. So a wise person decide to give 3% NS, correct it by 3% NS. Okay, so if you give 1 liter of 3% NS, what will be the change in sodium? So 513 minus 120 divided by 7. So this 7, how you get it? 0.6 into 8 will be 6 plus 1. So this is 7. So if you give 1 liter of 3% NS, there will be 56 change per liter. Okay, so what we need to, we need only a change of 10. So we can give only 180, so 1 liter will change by 56. So we can give 180 ml 3% NS in 20 hours. So that will be approximately 6 ml per hour of 3% NS. So these are the different ways by which you can manage the maintenance phase of hyponatremia correction. But practically, I tell you this Andromeda's formula, though it's a good theoretical, practically we don't use it so often. What we do is after the immediate correction by 3% NS is over, we just start NS hypertonic fluid, that's NS or a DNS infusion with minimal 3% NS infusion, serially monitor. Just check the sodium after 4 hours. So in 4 hours, you want a change of 2, right? 0.5 mCq per every hour. So after 4 hours, you check the sodium. Okay, if the sodium has increased by 2, you are happy, continue the same. If the sodium is increasing rapidly, decrease the infusion rate. If the sodium is not increasing with the target, 4 hours, you check the sodium, you find the sodium same, then increase your 3% NS infusion. So that is another way you can do it. The serial monitoring and titration is more important. Okay, so now the treatment, when to stop rapid correction, if the cessation of life-threatening symptoms have stopped and the sodium level, we have achieved a sodium of 130, then you need not continue IV correction. If the patient is otherwise well, you can start oral fluids and just monitor. Okay, and in other cases, if you started the long-term management. So what will happen if you rapidly correct? So that is the dangerous complication, central pontine myelinosis. So understand, in a chronic hyponatremia, just that if the patient is symptomatic or if the level is less than 120, you can give 1.5 ml per kg bolus. After that is okay, that won't cause any problem. But afterwards, the correction should be slow, maximum 0.5 mEq per hour. So if you exceed that, if you rapidly correct it, the brain shrinkage, tearing of brain cells can happen, which will lead, which is what we call central pontine myelinosis. The symptoms may include confusion, agitation, quadriparesis, and even death. Okay, so there will be characteristic radiologic changes of central pontine myelinosis. Your radiologist will report it in. So it is common in chronic hyponatremia, not in acute hyponatremia. So it is because of the adaptation of brain cells to hyponatremia. And when you rapidly correct it, the brain cells just shrink, they get rehydrated, and they develop central pontine myelinosis. So if you find that you have overcorrected, so fourth hourly you checked and you find that there has been a rapid increase. So you can manage it by free water or a 5% glucose, or in patients who are already on desmopressin, you can give desmopressin. Okay, so just to add on, in hypovolemic hyponatremia, for example, a patient with diarrhea coming with hypovolemia with hyponatremia, diarrhea patient. So in that patient, if the patient is in shock, then the initial fluid resuscitation will be by isotonic fluid like NS. Initial fluid resuscitation, then you start correcting the then if the patient is symptomatic, you give 3% NS bolus for correcting the immediate symptomatic management of hyponatremia. Then you start the maintenance management of hyponatremia. Okay, so hypovolemic hyponatremia. So these two entities, cerebral salt wasting, this is a hypovolemic hyponatremia. SIADH is a isovolemic or euvolemic hyponatremia. So you should know the difference. This can be asked in MCQs or this can be asked in your theory exam. So both causes hyponatremia. So cerebral salt wasting, it is a hypovolemic state. There will be negative fluid balance. The CVP low means there is hypovolemia. Urine, there is a polyuria. Why this occur in severe cerebral injury, there can be increased secretion of natriuretic peptides. So there will be a lot of sodium loss through the urine, which will result in polyuria and hypovolemia. Okay, so urine sodium will be more than 20. Here also, it will be more than 20. So again, you see here, even with hypovolemia, urine sodium is more than 20 because there is an increased natriuretic peptides. Plasma osmolality will be low in both, and urine osmolality will be high in both. So the basically how you differentiate, it is basically by the volume status. This is a hypovolemic state. SIADH is a euvolemic state. The other differentiation factor is the urine output. It will be high, and in SIADH, the urine output will be low or low normal. Okay. So salt wasting, how you manage, you replenish the volume, you correct the primary pathology, or you treat if it is a chronic meningitis, you treat it. And in refractory cases, we do add fludrocortisone to retain water and sodium. So just one slide about cerebral salt wasting. It is a concept which was recognized as early as 1950. So over the years, this diagnosis has been controversial. So the severe brain injury secrete natriuretic factors, natriuresis plus volume depletion. Okay. Now, in a recent study, it was shown that in patient with hyponatremia, when they measured CVP and the volume status accurately, only 6% were because of CSW, all the rest were because of SIADH. So I mean to say that cerebral salt wasting is not so common, it's rare, but SIADH is far more common. So CSW, we usually see only in patient with severe brain injury, severe traumatic brain injury, or chronic CNS injury, like chronic TB meningitis, all those patients. Okay, now coming to the treatment of hypervolemic hyponatremia, for example, congestive cardiac failure. So in these patients, the treatment of hyponatremia as such is difficult. So this patient has both excess water and sodium, but the water is much more than the sodium. Okay, so while the patients are retaining water and sodium because their ineffective intravascular volume, increased ADH secretion, and increased activated RAS mechanism. Okay, so in this patient, for example, a CCF patient with a sodium of 120, if you give 3% NS, he is neurologically normal provided. If you give a 3% NS bolus, what will happen? So it can be disastrous because you know CCF, they have pulmonary edema. Already the patient is overloaded. So in such a patient, if you give 3% NS bolus, there will be sudden worsening of pulmonary edema can happen. So sudden worsening of volume overload can happen. So how to manage hyponatremia in such patients? So in such patients, again CCF, there will be, you decrease the preload, you restrict both water and sodium, and you treat the underlying cause of decreased effective intracircular volume. So the culprit is decreased effective intracircular volume, which is activating the kidney to secrete RAS, which is retaining more water and sodium. So the culprit, so you have to treat the cause. So in CCF, the treat is decreased cardiac output. So you give better treatment for that. That is, you give inotropy, you increase the cardiac contractility, so you improve the effective circulatory volume. So automatically the sodium will settle. And the other modality is give diuretics, restrict water intake. So that will be the modality of treatment in such patients. So what about the other cohort, nephrotic syndrome patient with hyponatremia? Again, third spacing, there is hyponatremia. In such patients, what you do? So the again, the culprit is decreased intravascular volume is the one culprit of hyponatremia in nephrotic syndrome. So what you do, you give albumin infusion, and then you can expand the intravascular volume. So that will give you that will improve your sodium. And after expanding intravascular volume, you can give diuretics, which will excrete the water, and that will improve your sodium. So you don't give 3% NS infusion for such patients, unless they are symptomatic. Now CCF again, so you have to improve the cardiac output, that is culprit there, okay. So renal failure, you cannot manage because our primary route of excretion is kidney. If that itself is at fault, then the only way you can try is fluid restriction. And if the patient still has hyponatremia, then you will have to go for dialysis. Okay, so now imagine a patient comes with a CCF patient, a present with a sodium of 116, with encephalopathy, and patient is dilated cardiomyopathy seizures. So you are in this scenario, you know, so what I told initially, if the patient is symptomatic with hyponatremia, whatever may be the etiology, you have to give 3% NS bolus. But the trick here is the patient also has CCF. So what can you do? So in such patient, you give 3% NS, with that you give Lasix also. With that you give diuretics, so that body, you give volume, but you give Lasix also, to excrete the free water, okay. So coming to SAADH, so SAADH, you know, there is a euvolemia or a hypervolemia. Again, the modality of treatment will be fluid restriction. So fluid restriction, gradually you give only 2/3 maintenance. That is why for any patient, any sicker patient, any patient severe bronchiolitis, severe meningitis, severe pneumonia, severe asthma, you give only 2/3 or 70% strat fluids. So you have to anticipate SAADH in such patients. Give only 70% maintenance fluid and don't give hypotonic fluid, 70% isotonic maintenance fluid give for the patient so that SAADH can be prevented. So your fluid restriction obviously requires time. So once the SAADH is already established, what you do? You restrict the fluid to 60 to 75% and then treat the underlying cause. If it is asthma, severe pneumonia, treat the cause also. Now, imagine a SAADH patient, what will happen if you give a lot of 3% saline? So just imagine a SAADH patient, your sodium is just 130 only, but if somebody give overzealously, give 3% NS to such patient, he is not symptomatic, what will happen? The body, the ADH levels are very high. So out of the 3% NS you give, what will be the body do? Body will just excrete the sodium in this fluid and just retain the water alone. So this will, so giving 3% NS alone to such patient will actually aggravate your hyponatremia. Or in fact, if you give a lot of IV fluid to such patient, your hyponatremia will be further aggravated. So you have to restrict the fluid to such patients. Okay, so there can be an entity called chronic SAADH, again in a chronic CNS patients. I'm not going to the details of that. In such patients, you may use democlocycline and lithium. So these are used in such patients. This can blunt ADH response, okay. Now, just I will mention on Vaptans. So V2 receptor antagonist, there ADH antagonist which is approved for treatment of SAADH, also approved for treatment of hypervolemia, like for example, CCF related hyponatremia in adults, especially they use it very often, Vaptans. So it is approved for you SAADH, you can use Vaptans. Okay, so but though promising, it is routinely not recommended because we need more trials. Okay, okay. So now again, there's a very catch here. If a patient is hypovolemic hyponatremia, for example, a patient is having salt wasting. To such patient, if you give optans, what can happen? It can aggravate. Okay, so it is only for patients because it's a ADH antagonist. Only for patient who have euvolemia or hypervolemia. So just this is the last slide on hyponatremia. Just we are summarizing again. So we are talking about true hyponatremia or hypotonic hyponatremia. Okay, we check the volume status. It is hypovolemic. Okay, there can be, then you check the urine sodium. So in this, the treatment will be isotonic saline. So if it is symptomatic, give 3% NS, and then you give isotonic saline, NS or DNS infusion, and closely monitor. So that will be the treatment in hypovolemic hyponatremia. So euvolemic hyponatremia, you check the urine sodium, you know it is more than 20. You to classify between SIADH and polydipsia, you can check the urine osmolality. So the treatment here in the euvolemic, it will be fluid restriction. Okay. Now the other is hypervolemic, like classical example is our congestive cardiac failure. So there the treatment will be fluid and sodium restriction plus diuretics. So this slide just summarizes how you evaluate hyponatremia and how you treat each of them. So we are about to finish the hyponatremia slides. So we'll now go back to the 6 examples we cited. So for each question, you just give the answers in the chat box. So the first example, you can read and give the answer in the chat box. Just write what is the type of hyponatremia and what's the treatment. Nabil, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. There are no answers yet.
We can wait for 1 or 2 minutes.
Hypervolemic hyponatremia, diuretic, and many are answering the same. Hypervolemic hyponatremia.
Okay. So very good. So that this will be hypervolemic hypernatremia. So there are signs of edema. There are signs of hypervolemia. So the sodium, so don't give NS or 3% to this patient. So the treatment will be diuresis. Then the treatment will be sodium and water restriction. Okay. And another treatment will be you treat the dilated cardiomyopathy. If the patient is going for shock, add inotropy and increase the intravascular volume, which will blunt your RAS response and which will obviously improve your hyponatremia. Okay. Then very good. The next scenario.
SIADH. SIADH. Yes. You have answered as SIADH.
Very good. Treatment.
Euvolemic hyponatremia. Euvolemic.
Just treatment. No.
Fluid restriction.
Yes. Very good. Okay. So very good. So this is severe bronchiolitis. So these patients can have SIADH, and even on top of that, we were giving 100%, which should not have been done, and that too we were giving hypotonic fluid. So all has contributed to hyponatremia. So the treatment again will be just restrict the fluid to 60%, give isotonic fluid 60% DNS or 60% to 70% DNS or NS. And just watch on, that will improve. Okay. Third scenario. Sorry. Answers, Nabil?
No answers yet. Wait. One answer, CFW. Cerebral salt wasting.
Very good. Treatment. Treatment.
Treatment. No one has mentioned. We'll wait. No one has given the treatment. A restriction of fluid by one. Yeah, fluid restriction.
No. Okay, so cerebral salt wasting.
One answer, there is 3%. saline.
Very good. Okay, so just see, it's a chronic CNS case. Patient was having poor GCS. Meant to say patient was symptomatic. There was polyuria and sign tachycardia. So there it is hypovolemic. So it is a hypovolemic hyponatremia. So in this background, you will consider cerebral salt wasting because polyuria is also there. So it is a cerebral salt wasting hypovolemic hyponatremia. So GCS could be because of the low sodium. So the first point will be to give a 3% NS bolus. Because its sodium is less than 120, it is symptomatic, give 3% NS bolus. And from there, the correction should be very slow. As we discussed later earlier, very slow, like 0.5 MEQ maximum per hour will give a slow correction. And some cases, some of these salt wasting cases can be refractory. Again, you find after 2-3 days also, you find that sodium is not improving. Such patients, we add low dose fludrocortisone. Okay, next case.
No one has answered yet. Hypovolemic hyponatremia.
Very good.
Hyponatremia, symptomatic with 3% bolus followed by maintenance.
Yes. Okay, so it's a simple scenario. So it's a hypovolemic hyponatremia. So just because the baby is seizing, you have to give a 3% NS bolus, then start gradual correction. Okay, so this patient is also having, just observe this patient is also having 178 tachycardia, cold peripheries. So with 3% NS bolus, you will need to give a NS bolus also to this patient to improve the hemodynamics. Okay. So this hypovolemia causing shock that you should correct with an isotonic fluid. Okay, next two ones are easy ones. Just one word answer.
Hypervolemia.
Okay. I didn't mention the osmolality here. Actually, the serum osmolality was 290.
Lot of answers as hypervolemic hyponatremia, but...
No. That's why I'm mentioning the serum osmolality was 290. So just the catch is here. Okay. So triglyceride was 300. This was just a pseudo hyponatremia. But all of you, what you told in nephrotic syndrome, if there is a lot of edema, there can be a hypervolemic hyponatremia also contributed. But so I should have mentioned this was a pseudo serum osmolality was normal. Okay. So it was 285. So it is a pseudo hyponatremia. So last example.
Pseudo hyponatremia, volume to be corrected with albumin, followed by diuretic. No, I think that is the answer.
So I told you this hyperosmolarity. So hyperosmolarity related hyponatremia, it is actually not pseudo hyponatremia. There is a hyponatremia. But it has happened because there are a lot of osmotically other active substances, be it glucose or mannitol, which has dragged water from the cells and diluted the sodium. So the hyponatremia is not pseudo. It's actually there is hyponatremia. But once you correct that hyperosmolarity, that is once you give insulin to this patient, glucose level will fall down and sodium will automatically increase. Okay. So this is hyperosmolarity related hyponatremia. Okay. So that is why we have to calculate the corrected sodium level. And these patients do not have symptoms of hyponatremia because their osmolarity is high. Okay. So next we move on to hypernatremia. I'm sorry that I've exceeded time. Nabil, what should I do? Whether I should continue or?
I think we can continue, sir, because everybody will be interested.
Okay. Because the sodium, because it takes a lot of time, I cannot rush through the slides. That's why I was a bit slow. Okay, but hypernatremia, I think I can finish another 20 minutes or so. So hypernatremia, it is easier than this hyponatremia. There are no much confusion like hyponatremia. Okay, so hypernatremia, sodium more than 145. So again, could be the loss of body water relative to sodium. So hypernatremia means either the sodium has increased or both sodium and water increased, but the sodium increase was much more than the water. Okay. So again, the prevalence of hypernatremia in hospitalized children is up to 2%. So hypernatremia was around 25%, but hypernatremia is actually rare compared to hyponatremia. Okay. So it is mostly iatrogenic. Only 20 out of this 2% also, only 20% are admitted with hypernatremia. All others are iatrogenic. So in a study, the factors contributing to the ICU acquired hypernatremia, the main factors were polyuria, renal failure, hypertonic solutions like hypertonic saline or soda bicarbonate, fever, which lead to loss of water, or diarrhea. So all these were the probable culprits of ICU acquired hypernatremia. Okay, so these tables are taken from your Nelson. So the cause could be excessive sodium, water deficit, or both water and sodium deficit. So excessive sodium, the common causes are excess soda bicarbonate or excess sodium chloride, intentional salt, all these are very rare, and excess hypertonic saline and all. So water deficits, the commonest, and what you should remember is diabetic insipidus, could be central or nephrogenic, and both water sodium deficit, but sodium water loss is more than the sodium loss. So that is diarrhea. Again, I already mentioned hypernatremic dehydration, which classically happens in infancy and old age, where the children or the old age people who cannot regulate their oral water intake, the thirst mechanism is not proper. Otherwise, also in cutaneous other losses like burns, excessive sweating, all this, and some renal disorders, hypernatremia can happen. So what are the symptoms of hypernatremia? So the symptoms will be, again, sodium is synonymous with the osmolality. It will be the symptoms of hyperosmolality. So classically, these patients, they have preserved intravascular volume. So they don't, even the hypernatremic dehydration, usually they don't go for shock because their intravascular volume is preserved. Volume moves from the cells to the blood vessel and intravascular volume is preserved. So usually they don't develop shock, okay? So they have classically this duffy feel of the skin because of the intracellular dehydration, and that can cause CNS symptoms, which again will depend not only on the level of sodium, but also on the rapidity of elevation, how rapidly the hypernatremia has developed, okay? So in infants, the symptoms can be a hypopnea, hyperapnea, high-pitched cry, restlessness, etc. And the alert patients are thirsty, and hypernatremic patients, this you can observe, these patients also develop hyperglycemia and mild hypocalcemia, which do not, this hyperglycemia relate, which happens in hypernatremia, does not need a treatment by its own. If you correct the hypernatremia, sugar also will get normalized. So what are the complications? Again, if suddenly the tonicity increases, the cell shrinkage, brain cell shrinkage will happen, which can lead to the tearing of intracerebral and bridging vessels, like intracerebral hemorrhage can happen, which can include subdural, subarachnoid, and different kind of hemorrhage. Even the thromb, because of the increase in osmolarity or viscosity, even stroke and sinus thrombosis can rarely happen. Okay, so how you evaluate the hypernatremia? So first will be the history. We'll ask was there any history of fluid loss? Were there any history of any excess salt intake or any IV soda bicarb or 3% saline therapy? So that history we have to take. Now again, the assessment, we have to check the volume status, and investigation, we have to check urine and serum osmolality. So again, in hypernatremia also, it can be hypovolemic. So hypovolemic hypernatremia is because the patient has lost more water and less sodium. Okay, so classical example is hypernatremic dehydration. Then the patient can be euvolemic, and the patient can be hypervolemic in rare endocrine diseases like hyperaldosteronism, Cushing syndrome, etc. So treatment of hypernatremia, again, there can be two-pronged approach. One is we have to address the underlying cause, why the hypernatremia has happened. For example, patient is having loose stools, we have to replace that. If the patient is having a severe fever and sweating, we have to control the fever and correct the underlying cause, and now treat the hypertonicity. So here, what we are trying to treat, we want to gradually decrease the tonicity of blood to normal. We want that, and the treatment should be very gradual. So this same figure what we saw in hyponatremia, this you should remember, if there is a hypertonicity happening in the blood vessel, okay, so initially there can be movement of water from the brain to the blood vessel, which will lead to cell shrinkage. Now over 48 hours, what happens? The brain accumulates some osmols, some ideogenic osmols. This is exactly the mechanism which happens in diabetic ketoacidosis also. So brain accumulates some osmols and brain gradually adapt to the hypertonic state. Okay, now in such a patient, if we suddenly reduce the sodium, what will happen? So brain is now brain is adapted to hypertonic state. If we suddenly reduce the sodium here, what will happen? Water will suddenly move to brain. So that will cause cerebral edema. Okay, so we should correct it gradually. So the same mechanism why you should, in diabetic ketoacidosis, there is a hyperosmolar state. So why you should correct DKA slowly, gradually over 24 to 48 hours? If you rapidly correct, again the same problem can happen. There can be sudden occurrence of cerebral edema and neurological consequences. So now how we correct it? If it is a prolonged or unknown duration, for any patient coming in a casualty, we assume it's chronic, it's of unknown duration. So we need a slope-based correction. And if the patient is having hypovolemia, for example, classically a hypernatremic dehydration patient has a lot of loose stool, infant who did not consume enough water, that patient sodium will be 160. Or another example could be a patient with a diarrhea, the mother gave improperly diluted or concentrated ORS, again the patient will present with hypernatremic dehydration. So if the patient is having dehydration, so first thing is you correct the hypovolemia with NS bolus, isotonic bolus. That itself will control your hyponatremia bit. Then start slow correction. So again, the maximum correction is 0.5 mm per hour. So if you want to reduce the sodium by 10, it should be done within 20 hours at least. The targeted fall in 24 hours will be 10 to 12. So, for example, if a hypernatremia has happened rapidly, for example, a patient sodium was, hypothetical scenario was 140 in the morning, and somebody inadvertently gave a lot of 3% NS to the patient, and by afternoon you saw that the sodium has now gone to 160. So you are sure that this is an accidental loading, this is a rapidly acquired hypernatremia. In such a patient, you can correct it rapidly because the brain has not adapted. Okay, so in such patient, up to 1 mm per hour correction is can be done without any consequences. Okay, so what is the goal of treatment in hypernatremia? We have to gradually bring down the sodium to 145. So gradually, remember gradually. So make whatever the ongoing losses is happening, that you have to correct. Okay, now in patients with seizures, for example, hypernatremia patient has developed seizures, you have to promptly stabilize such patients. So how to correct hypernatremia? For that, you need to understand the concept of free water deficit. Okay, and we should calculate what is the free water deficit, and we determine the rate of desired correction. We replace the ongoing losses, frequently monitor and titrate. So what is free water deficit? So this concept of free water, so free water means the water which is devoid of sodium. Okay, so it means 100 ml dextrose, 5% dextrose, that contain 100 ml free water, or 100 ml distilled water, it contain 100 ml free water. Okay, 100 ml NS contain no free water. So it is amount of fluid which is devoid of normal saline. Okay, now 100 ml N/2 5% dextrose, that will contain 50 ml free water. Okay, so it is 50 ml free water plus 50 ml normal saline produces 100 ml N/2 saline. Okay, so this is the concept of free water. So hypernatremia happens because we have lost some free water. So we have lost some water which is devoid of sodium, so that has concentrated our blood and that has produced the hypernatremia. So while correcting, we have to calculate how much free water we have lost. Okay, so there are different formulas. So the water deficit is calculated by total body water initial minus total body water during hypernatremia. So this initial total body water will be weight into 0.6. So into 1 minus 145 by correct sodium. Current, this is one way, or the simplest way I will tell you, just remember this. So 4 ml per kg per level of sodium more than 145. For example, if the weight is 10 kg, sodium is 160. So what is the free water deficit? It will be 4 into 10 into sodium above 145, which is 15. So the free water deficit will be 40 into 15, which will be 600 ml. So in this patient, free water deficit is 600 ml. So this is, just remember this formula. 4 ml, that is the free water deficit. Now, how to correct, how to administer this free water? So it can be done orally or by a feeding tube in a patient who is otherwise stable. In critically ill patient, we need IV correction. Okay, so what fluid to give? So we have to give a fluid with some free water, right? So we cannot give isotonic saline. It's unsuitable for correction, but useful for restoration of intravascular volume. So I said hypernatremic dehydration, presenting with rehydration, just to correct the volume, you can give isotonic saline. Then you have to use hypotonic fluids. And you have to replace the ongoing losses. So only hypotonic fluids are appropriate, like pure water, 5% dextrose, 0.2%, 0.45% saline, that is the N by 2 saline, RL with the sodium will be 132. So the more hypotonic the fluid, the lower the infusion rate required. Now we will see some examples. Okay. Now again, if you want some advanced formulas, again the Adrogmedius has given some equation to calculate how much sodium will fall if you give 1 liter of hypotonic fluid. So we'll go with this example. Imagine 2.5-year-old boy with cerebral palsy, presented with history of loose stool for 2 days. Heart rate was 120, his hemodynamics was okay, pulses well palpable, and sodium was 161. Okay, so you see the catch here, cerebral palsy. I intentionally mentioned it because he is a neurologically abnormal patient, so he cannot regulate his oral water intake. That is why he has developed hypernatremic dehydration. Okay, so somebody, I think the weight is already, weight given as 10 kg. So somebody calculate the free water deficit. And just I need two answers, Nabil. One is, what is the free water deficit, and what is the duration by which we plan to normalize the sodium?
No answers yet.
Can give one more minute, just one more minute. What is the free water deficit?
So free water deficit is given as 640 ml. Four answers are there.
Excellent, excellent.
And more are writing 340. Yeah, 640.
Excellent. Okay. Okay. So in this patient, so we'll discuss the management. Okay. So this patient, there is no hemodynamics is maintained. There is no shock. So you don't need to give a fluid bolus, NS bolus to this patient. Had the same patient in shock, hypernatremic dehydration, we need to give a NS bolus. So we are having hypovolemic hypernatremia, GI loss. Okay. So how to correct which fluid, which rate, that we have to determine. So free water deficit. So you forget this formula. Just remember this. So exactly as you, many of you answered, it is 640 ml. Okay. So how to give 640 ml of free water? Okay. So the target sodium, so we have to correct is sodium 16 from to up to 145. So we need a correction of 16. So we need a minimum time of 32 hours. Okay. So we need to give 640 ml of free water over 32 hours. Okay. So how to give that? So plus that, the ongoing losses, give maintenance fluid, all those management have to go hand in hand. So 640 ml free water, how can we give? Either you can give 640 ml of distilled water or D5, or you can give, practically what you give is, we can give 1000, this is double the amount, 1280 ml of N by 2 saline, or the common fluid what we use, N by 2, 5% dextrose, half DNS, that 100 ml of DNS will contain 50 ml free water. So for 640 ml free water, we can give 1.3 liters approximately of half DNS. Okay. So that you have to give over 32 hours. So if you divide by this by 32, you know by every hour, how much fluid, how much n by 2, 5% we have to give every hourly. Okay. So again, if somebody wants to go advanced and wants to understand Archimedes' equation, so again, somebody, if you want to know, if you give 1 liter of half DNS to a patient with sodium of 161, what will happen? So 1 liter of is again the infusate sodium, like the patient sodium minus the infusate sodium divided by total body water plus 1. So if 1 liter will reduce the sodium by 12. So you want to reduce the sodium by 16, right? So you ought to give around 1.25 liters of n by 2, 5% dextrose. So again, the almost the same formula we are getting with, without the help of the formula also, we can calculate. It's almost the same you get by Archimedes. Okay, now just imagine somebody, a newcomer, he decided to give NS. He decided to give NS to the patient with a sodium of 161. And so he just calculate by Archimedes' formula. 1 liter of NS, if you give to a patient with 161, it will just reduce the sodium by 1. So that is why you don't use NS to correct or isotonic fluid to correct hypernatremia. So even if you give 2 liters of NS, the sodium will fall only by 2. Okay. So not confusing you much. So you can calculate the free water by 4 ml per kg per with the amount of sodium above 145. So just know that there is a formula called Archimedes' formula. Even in ICU, even the intensivists, we don't use this formula. But you should know that there is a way to calculate that. Okay. Now, how reliable? I told you a lot of formulas, and how reliable are these formulas? So all these formulas, they are just a rough guide. Okay, they are just a rough guide, and the best way and what you should do is, we should serially monitor the sodium, whenever you are correcting hyponatremia or hypernatremia, at least fourth hourly, you should check the sodium and see whether it's going as per our target and titrate the fluid accordingly. So hypernatremic dehydration, even Nelson also mentioned, the simplest way to do it is you give a fluid of N by 2 to N by 3 saline and maintenance of 20 to 30%. Like, for example, a patient of weight 10 kg. So if you don't want to remember all these formulas, the sodium is 161. What you do is just start 1.5 times the maintenance fluid. That will be, so normal maintenance will be 1 liter per day. So just start 1.5 liter per day of N by 2, 5% dextrose. Okay, or N by 2 saline. Small child, you give dextrose containing fluid. Just start 1.5% N by 2, 5% dextrose. That's so, okay. So just start that maintenance fluid for 24 hours. So for the 10 kg, it will start 1.5 liter per day and serially start checking. And every 4 hours, you check the sodium. So after starting 1.5 time maintenance fluid, N by 2, 5%, after 4 hours, you see that the sodium has fallen to 159 or 158, it is okay. Approximately the sodium is 0.5 MEQ per hour. So you can continue the same. Now, if you find that the sodium is as not, if you check after 4 hours, find that sodium is still 160 or has gone up, then what will you need to do? So you can do two things, either increase the rate of fluid further, but already we are giving 1.5. So the wise strategy will be make the fluid more hypotonic. So make it 1.5 times N by 4 or N by 5. N by 4, the common fluid you get is isolate piece, approximately N by 5. So if the sodium is not falling, make it N by 4 or N by 5. Again, check after 4 hours what is happening and you can titrate accordingly. Now, if you feel that even with N by 2, you find that the sodium is 161, the sodium has fallen to 155, which is very unlikely to happen practically. But if such a scenario happens, you can do two things. Either you, instead of 1.5 times maintenance, you just decrease it to 1 times maintenance. That is, you decrease the rate of fluid, or you, what you can do, you make the fluid more concentrated. You use a fluid with sodium of 130 or 100 or 130, the 2/3 NS or something like RL you can use in such a scenario. So simple treatment, 1.5 times maintenance fluid of N by 2, 5% XO, serially monitor and take a decision. That is a simple treatment for hypernatremic dehydration. So this you should remember, because hypernatremic dehydration is the practically you in your clinical practice, I give you guarantee you will encounter once in a while such patients. Okay. So again, important is monitoring, serial monitoring 3 to 4 hourly, and if rapid fall, increase the concentration or decrease the rate, and give normal saline if any signs of volume depletion. And what now you start correcting hypernatremia, and you suddenly you find that patient is started throwing seizures. So what you should suspect? So you should suspect that you have rapidly corrected the sodium, which has resulted in cerebral edema. So don't check, you do check the sodium, but don't wait for the report. So if you, during correction, if a patient develops seizures, it is because of the rapid correction, unless proved otherwise. So if the patient is throwing seizures, what you do is you give a bolus of 3% NS. Okay. And you check the sodium level and give a bolus of 3% NS, which will revert the seizures. Now coming to hypervolemic hypernatremia. These are actually rare disorders. Usually by caused by iatrogenically by using drugs or so. So that in such patients you can use a loop diuretic plus replacement fluid, hypotonic fluid. Okay. Now Nabil, this is a case scenario. So 7-month-old child is transferred to PICU with diagnosis of meningitis. Child was on NG feed, and the sodium, the resident found that sodium level were persistently above 160. So child has not received any 3% NS or any soda bicarb during the stay. Urea, creat, and the renal functions are normal. You just checked the vital records. You found that there is a little patient is having tachycardia. Patient's urine output, some records are in the polyuric range, and the patient has gone to dehydration. So what is the likely possibility? Answers, QUK. Symbol, hypernatremia, polyuria, neurologically abnormal.
Nabil? Diabetes insipidus, I think one answer is there, DI. Then central diabetes insipidus, cerebral salt.
Okay, so very good. So it is central diabetes insipidus, not salt wasting. It is hypernatremia. Okay, salt wasting is hyper. It is hyponatremia. Here it is hypernatremia. Okay. So we are dealing with central DI, central diabetes insipidus. So the so these three diagnoses, SIADH, CSW, both have hyponatremia, but in DI it is hypernatremia. Okay, so there is no doubt. There is hypernatremia, there is increased serum osmolite, is true hypernatremia, and but the patient is passing, because there is a ADH deficiency, even with hypernatremia, patient is passing dilute urine. Okay, so body is concentrating the sodium further and further. So that is the pathology here. Okay, the patient will be having polyuria and dilute urine. Urine sodium will be low. So central DI, it can come as a short note. Just remember what are the causes. So common will be chronic CNS illnesses, like even CNS infection, meningococcus, listeria, meningitis, some malignancies, classically craniopharyngioma. You should remember this. Some drugs can cause DI, very rare. And traumatic brain injury, there can be post-intracranial surgery. And I tell you the most common scenario what we see practically is, one is post-craniopharyngioma DI. Second is just impending brain death. A patient with severe brain injury, just before brain death, what happens is patients develop hyperglycemia, hypernatremia, and polyuria. So if you see DI developing in a patient with a severe severe brain injury, it is a sign that that patient is going for brain death. Okay. So now you it is central DI is one of the commonest cause in the ICU will be the post-operative period of resection of craniopharyngioma. So even in BMH, we had one patient last month, post-operative patient of craniopharyngioma. So this is called triphasic response. I think this is not mentioned in Nelson's, but it's very important. Okay. So post-op phase of craniopharyngioma, you then need strict monitoring, because they develop triphasic response. They develop initially a transient DI in the first 24 hours. It is because of the absence of release of ADH from neurons. Later, they develop SIADH. transient ADH for the next 48 hours because of the sudden recovery of stem cells and producing ADH, and later they go for permanent DI because of the permanent damage to ADH secreting neurons. So ultimately, they have permanent diabetes insipidus. So the first 72 hours management of the post-operative phase of craniopharyngioma should be done in the pediatric ICU, should be strictly monitored because of this triphasic response. It can be very tricky and you need to periodically monitor to understand what's happening. So how you manage central DI? So again, you have to correct with the hypotonic. There's a severe hypernatremia. Correct with hypotonic fluid. So in DI, you don't try with N by 2. You directly go with N by 4 or N by 3 or N by 5 even. And you monitor the urine output. So these patients will be in dilute urine, which is very polyuria. So you have to monitor the urine output every hourly or so. And at least fourth hourly or sixth hourly, you have to replace the urine output also. So how will you replace the urine output? Or the question is, which what fluid you will replace the urine output? So usually urine replacement in ICU is done with N by 2 saline, but in DI, the urine is very dilute. It is usually of the concentration of N by 4 or N by 5. So the best fluid to replace is either N by 4 or you check the urine sodium and whatever is the urine sodium. If you are getting it is 30, it is equivalent to N by 5, or if it is 70, it is around N by 2. So you replace the urine volume by volume every fourth hourly with N by 4 or the with a fluid of the same concentration of the urine. Okay, and if it is not resolving, you can start vasopressin infusion. So 0.005 unit per kg per hour. Just note that our inotropic dose will be 0.005 unit per kg per minute. So this is approximately 60 times less than the inotropic, very low dose vasopressin infusion you can start, and you target the urine output around 3 to 4 ml per kg per hour. You need to frequently check in central DI, and the chronic management, once we have stabilized, we will start desmopressin nasal spray as a replacement. Okay. So in chronic DI, once established DI patients like a post-op craniopharyngioma, they will be usually discharged on desmopressin or plus minus thiazides. Now, this is one indication. What are the indications of dialysis in hypernatremia? Okay, so one, if the patient's sodium level is 120, extreme severe hypernatremia, so usually in such patients, they will be symptomatic, they will be encephalopathic, they will may get ventilated also. So in such patient, you start hypotonic fluids at high maintenance rate, but usually be prepared for dialysis because such high sodium level, it's very difficult to control with fluids alone. Now, if a hypernatremic patient also has refractory fluid overload, so you cannot give further high amount of fluid to such patients, they might need dialysis. If the patient has kidney failure, then obviously that patient might need dialysis. Again, if a concomitant metabolic acidosis, a hypernatremic dehydration with sepsis, with shock, so you have hyponatremia, you have severe acidosis also, so you might need to give bicarb to such patients. So that soda bicarb itself will contain sodium. So in such patients with fluids alone, it will be difficult to manage. So that patients might need some form of renal replacement therapy. Or if you fail with conventional methods with a reasonably high severe hypernatremia, you may need dialysis. Nabil, that's done. I think if there are any questions, we can take it. I hope it was useful.
There were a few questions in the chat box. Yes. In your talk. One question was, sir, in hyponatremia, cell shrinkage during rapid correction lead to myelinosis. In hypernatremia, cell shrinkage lead to rupture of vessels. Why this difference of manifestation? That was one question.
Yeah, it's a good question. So both these manifestations are because of the cell shrinkage. Okay, so even in hypernatremia per se, acute hypernatremia per se can also cause cerebral pontine myelinosis. For severe a 6-month-old infant with severe hypernatremic dehydration, who was mother gave some concentrated ORS accidentally, a patient with sodium of 162, I have seen such a patient with central pontine myelinosis. So CP can happen due to sudden increase in sodium. So commonly it happens during the rapid correction of hypernatremia, but acute hypernatremia per se, when it happens too rapidly, can also have pontine myelinosis. So both phenomenon can happen in both scenarios. Okay.
Another question is there. Sir, if a baby comes on day 10 of life with hypernatremic dehydration, for correction, which weight should we be using if the current weight is less than the birth weight? Current weight or birth weight, which one?
Okay. Actually, that the question is a little tricky. I will have to confirm because it is neonatology. I am out of neonatology for a long time. I'll just confirm and tell you. I'll get you the answer. Okay. So I have to think about it and answer that question. Okay. What I think is we have to take the previous weight, not the current weight. We have to take the previous weight to calculate. But I'll just, because it's a newborn related. I admit that I have to just confirm it and tell you. Okay. Because newborns, again, the sodium handling, newborns, you all know that first 48 hours, we give only sodium-free fluids. And after 48 hours, you can give sodium, so because their sodium handling is, renal sodium handling is very poor. You give maintenance fluids as ISOP till newborn period, like till 1 month of age. Okay. So that is allowed, and because you don't give more than sodium with like even N/2 saline, you don't give for a newborn. Their sodium handling is different, and again they are prone for hypernatremic dehydration. You are right in that. I think you have to take the previous weight, but I need to confirm and tell you. I will just confirm with a neonatologist and tell you. Okay.
Okay. So we don't have any more questions. I invite Dr. Ajit Kumar sir, HOD, Pediatrics, Government Medical College, Calicut, to conclude the session. Sir, you are mute.
Rauf, your session I was looking forward to for the last few days, and yes, it was really excellent talk. And I think most of the PGs, most of these questions would have been solved. And for those who wants to know more, I think they have to go and read about this hyponatremia and hypernatremia. Then come back again to his talk and clarify the doubts. Very, very important, because
yes, sir, yes, sir.
This is a day. It cannot be what you call taught in once a lecture. Actually, it has to be taught. Self-learning is very important, as you rightly said. From each patient, we have to learn and how to manage each of these hyponatremia and hypernatremia. And it was really excellent. And you took what you call just like a. Each slide, you didn't rush through it, and you tried to explain everything in detail. I really liked that, and I was there throughout this session. I really enjoyed it, and I hope that it will be useful for all the postgraduate students. Thank you, Rauf, and I would like to have more talks like that on metabolic acidosis and how to do the ABG. I think Nabil, we should have more talks from Rauf.
Yes, sir. I'm ready anytime, sir. I like to teach, actually.
Yeah. It is very evident that you are a good teacher. Yeah. Very evident. Thank you, Nihal.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for the nice words.
Okay, then we can conclude.
Okay, Nabil. Thank you, Nabil.
Thank you.
And thank you all participants, all for the patient listening.